So France, known for its cheese, its baguettes, its fine wines, its French people and their terrible mood, its French kisses and its romanticism, its wines, its constitution wrought by a military coup nostalgic general, its guillotine, and its bad wines. France is a bit less known for its freedom-suppressing laws, its securitarian political system, which fights terrorism with sexism, its nationalist way of facing the refugees crisis, and its colonialism well implanted in its international agenda. In short, liberté, égalité, and fraternité are sometimes synonyms of travail, famille, patrie. France is also known worldwide for our knowledge and practice of law enforcement, which led 56 years ago to dozens of Algerians being drawn in the scene, to the point where we pride ourselves on this knowledge and this know-how, and we export that and anti-riot gear to various governments, for instance, Tunisia of Ben Ali. And now, France is shining for its anti-privacy lobbying, and we now have our anti-terrorist public prosecutor writing op-ed against cryptography in the New York Times. France, along with Germany and the United Kingdom, is also one of the biggest forces inside the European Union, and if it can get the two others on board, and I know it's complicated right now with the United Kingdom, but still, we can obtain what we want from our European partners. It works both ways, and if Germany wants something and can't get and can convince the France, they can have what they want. Ask the Greeks. I'm Okin, I'm the tech person working for La Quadrature du Net. We're an organization who fights for human rights in the digital era. And if I'm here today, it's to talk to you about the danger lying above your job, especially if you're writing and or maintaining cryptographic communication system. I'm also here because I think it is important to demonstrate and to expose that the worst repressing law we have in the European Union nowadays and in the world doesn't necessarily come from totalitarian and from far-right governments, such as Hungary or Poland, for instance, but mostly from the social democracy compatible with the market economy, to paraphrase Merkel. And being a French, I'm compelled to speak about freedom and to criticize my government. It's a long-standing tradition, and we cannot really resist any occasion to do it. So, I start with a quick, but sadly non-exhaustive, history of law trying to weaken or circumvent one way or another the cryptography. I will include everything about installing keyloggers and spywares on your devices because they are a direct threat against cryptographic communication systems. I must add that I won't speak about all of the internet aspects of the law, such as censorship, filtering, access to internet, because that can't take me hours, and we have even more laws regulating it in France and in the, European Union. So, let's get to year zero of cryptography freedom in France, which is 1998. The use of before 1998, basically, there was the use of you cannot use cryptography except if your asymmetric key length was under 128 bits, which is really not a lot. And it was that way because the intelligence community and the military did want to keep things under control. After lengthy negotiation with the intelligence services, so it was back then the DST, the IRG, and the DGSE, the cryptography has been freed in 1998 if the system used respect one of those two limitations. The cryptography system can't be used for confidentiality purposes, so only authenticating mechanisms, safety of protocols, and this kind of stuff, like TLS, and etc. And the cryptography system is operated by a third party owning master key, which he can't give to the police if they ask for it. So if you wanted to write some cryptography system in France after 1998, you needed to fit into one of those two conditions. In 2001, and there's like a lot of them, and starting from 2001 and with the daily security law, which was made during the Jospin government, which is a left government with the Socialist Party. Depends on your definition of left, I guess. They freed the use of cryptography, but they required that the system used has been first registered at the Interior Ministry's office, which is a job now done by the ANSSI, which is a kind of the RSSI of the French Republic, I think. And since then, since 2001, cryptography legislation didn't really evolve. However, one law after another, and one safety and anti-terrorism law after another, and we had like 30 of them in the last 15 years, so you don't have all of them here. The judiciary and repressive arsenal toward cryptography did grow. For instance, police were authorized to install keyloggers with the LOBC2 in 2011. Then they became able to force any person or entity they think able to decrypt, decipher, or analyze every encrypted content they get their hands on, and that's been done in the anti-terrorism law of 2014. And they can ask help to do this crypto analysis to the army and the intelligence community. So yeah, you get search in the street and the DGSE can search your phone. Black boxes, and we now know they are made by Palantir, entered the game in the intelligence, into the intelligence law, too complicated name, in 2015. Basically, there are wiretaps at the global level on the internet infrastructure in France. They're controlled by algorithms who are trying to collect and analyze metadata in order to catch terrorists. Good luck with that. In the same law, the use of IMSI catchers is granted to cops, and they can now install spyware without prior validation of a judge. They still need a warrant, but it's delivered after the fact and by a judge without any investigative power. So basically, they don't really require a warrant. Thanks to the state of emergency, after the Bataclan attack in November 2015, search warrants in a more general level are now delivered after the fact by the same judges without any investigative power, and they allow for collection of any data for them site, as well as any data they can access from the hardware they see on site. So everything you have on your Dropbox, Google Cloud, or every computer you connect to using, for instance, SSH from a computer which is in your home is now fair game for them. So they can basically enter your company infrastructure if they made a search at your house. If data is encrypted, they're kept almost twice as long as if they're not encrypted. And this time is starting running after being decrypted. So they get your data, they can keep them forever if they're in an encrypted format. And if they can break the encryption, they can keep them longer. To conclude this depressive state of affair, I'll add that cryptography is an aggravating circumstance in a long list of crimes and felonies linked primarily to organized crime and terrorism, but also conveniently to aiding refugees. So if you're helping refugees and you're using, for instance, Signal or WhatsApp to synchronize yourself, you risk more jail time and more fines. And basically, encrypting things makes you even more suspect and more guilty. Oh, and I almost forgot. If ever you're operating a cryptographic system for third parties, you have an obligation to provide either decryption keys or plain text to the cops if they ask for it. You have 72 hours to comply. If you can't, you risk jail time and some fines. It probably can apply to yourself, so if you're getting caught using cryptography, maybe you have to give your key to the cops. We're not sure about that yet, because it might clash with the right to remain silent and to not self-incriminated. So, today in France, it is almost impossible to legally use cryptography, since giving access to such tools requires to register them and that there's no list of such tools made available by the INSSI. Again, maybe I'm wrong, but I did search on their website. I didn't find any list of what I can legally use in France to do cryptography. I shouldn't have to say that, but there is strong ties between cryptography and privacy. And there is a strong tie between privacy and freedom of organization and protest, for instance, or basically having a life. And we can consider that in France, in 2017, it's illegal to have privacy and to organize protest. And if anyone thought that Trump was hard on cryptography, but if the use of cryptographic tool is free, making those tools available is framed and submitted to registration. And that's why you didn't have chat secure in France on an iPhone, because the Apple App Store, for instance, requires this registration process. It requires you to have filled the paperwork with the INSSI. and to get the import certificate to make your tool available in France. ChatSecure and Keybase.io developers did file all the paperwork. It took them some months fighting with French administration, which is something that no sane person won't ever do voluntarily. So there's that. So I'm going to go into some doctrinal aspects that never changed since 1998, and I think they're especially important. Cryptography laws are vowed by intelligence agency and military. Every time they need something, they want to disrupt something, they will ask for a new law. They want to collect as much data as possible, multiple times, to have the capability to decrypt every conversation at any time. At this cost only, they opened the use of cryptographic tools to the general public. And they make a huge difference between cryptography used for security of communication, like how you can use TLS to be sure that you go on the correct website and that no one will intercept your PayPal account or whatever. And cryptography, which is used to enforce confidentiality, basically everything that's end-to-end encrypted. And they try to make a big difference between both of them. That was the case with the law of 1998, and that's the case in a lot of the talk we see today. A lot of the discourse in France is based on the fact that people who actually commit acts of terrorism did use cryptography, which in almost all the cases is false for this kind of reasons. However, almost all of the people who did commit a terror attack in France, but also in Belgium or Spain because they go through France, were known and watched by the French intelligence community and the cops. Basically, what they need is not more way to intercept encrypted communication, but it's just more manpower, more formation, more training. And to illustrate that it goes way beyond the classic lines of left-right politics, which we can suppose that, yeah, only the rightists ask for end of privacy, I'd like to display some quotes on the topic by various minister, candidate, elected representative, and other prominent political speaker. So, let's start with Eric Ciotti, which is an elected representative in the National Assembly from Les Républicains, which is a right to far right party, which is one of the biggest bloc after La République en Marche in the National Assembly. Among everything he said, he wants to fine Apple 1.5 million euros if they refuse to give up encryption keys. I think among everything he said, because he said a lot of stuff, he's speaking a lot and he's saying a lot of insane stuff, like worse than that. Like how he wants to send people back to Cayenne if they commit act of terrorism, or stripping them of the, or stripping the kamikaze who died from their nationality, which makes no sense because they're dead. This is the thing that is taking hold, and we've seen amendments in this direction like several times. In August 2016, there was a joint declaration of Thomas de Maizière, which is, if I'm right, the Interior Ministry of Germany, and Bernard Cazeneuve, which was the Interior Ministry of France, about an European internal security, and they basically stated that at the European level, it will require us to force the non-cooperative operator to remove illegal content or to decrypt messages during investigation. So by non-cooperative operators, he doesn't talk about the Google or Apple, I think. He wants to target something more like Signal or Telegram. In 2015, François Molin, which is the Parisian anti-terrorist prosecutor, wrote an op-ed in the New York Times against cryptography. This is the headline, the title is quite explicit. And he signed this bullshit with his colleague, Cyrus Vance Jr., District Attorney of Manhattan, Adrian Lepand, Commissioner of London City Police, and Javier Zaragoza, Chief Prosecutor of High Court of Spain. So you see France and Britain and some other country, but mostly France, is leading something here. Guillaume Poupard from the ANSSI said, sometime before the election in October 2015, when there was all this discussing about terrorism and cryptography, that backdoors and key sequestration is a bad idea. And that instead, we should focus on clear text points, whatever that means. It probably is a stand for transport security and against confidentiality in communication. So always this dichotomy, so this double use in cryptography that you can secure communication, but you shouldn't have confidentiality. Emmanuel Valls from the Socialist Party, well, we think so, we're not really sure about that. He was prime minister, he used the term legal cryptography in interviews in October 2015, and it was the first time that people spoke in this term, like, there is legal cryptography, it means that there is illegal cryptography. It was a divergent from the official discourse for the last 20 years, which stated that all cryptography is legal in France. And then we have the National Council of Digital Stuff, presided at the time by Mounir Majoubi. And they did write a report in August 2016, so just before the election, or just after, I think it was before. No, after. Bref. He opposed the idea of backdoors and did advocate for the use and development of end-to-end encryption. So it's like, it was August 2015, sorry, it's not 16. So they say, okay, we are the digital instance of the state and we advocate state and stuff, and it's nice to have encryption. At the time, Mounir Majoubi was head of this council, and it's important to note that somewhere in your head, you'll see later why. So, 2016, lots of election, a lot, UP. We had two primary for the Socialist Party and the Republican. We had a presidential election, and we have legislative election. So we basically spend our whole year watching political debate about stuff, including cryptography, and sometimes it's painful. You see here on only five of the candidates of the presidential campaign. There were 11 on the stage at this time. So you have from this side, you have Marine Le Pen, Jean-Luc Mélenchon, Emmanuel Macron, François Fillon, and Benoît Hamon, which are the leaders of the biggest political formation. And they were all talking on a TV stage. It's kind of fun and depressing, and you need to drink a lot to bear it. So, during his presidential campaign, Emmanuel Macron, I didn't make this photo up, said that we should put an end to cryptography by forcing the biggest companies to provide encryption keys or to give access to decrypted content. And he stated that one day, the GAFA will have to be held responsible for terror attack complicity. It was in April 2017. Then Mounir Majoubi, then considering the candidate and now internet minister, has been forced to backpedal and to explain that messing with end-to-end cryptography was out of question and that they'd rather force companies to cooperate faster with police forces, which I don't know what they really meant about that. Like, okay, they have to say faster to police that they can't decrypt stuff. I don't know. But what was important here is that a specific emphasis has been put at this time on the use of cryptography by companies to protect trade and industrial secrets. And since then, Mounir Majoubi has been MIA. To communicate with his political party and representatives, Emmanuel Macron, now president, used Telegram, which means he doesn't use his secure smartphone. It's an application that has been regularly described by a lot of representatives as an enabling terrorism tool and which should be banned, their words, not mine. So it's okay for him to use cryptography, but not for everyone because reasons. And coupled with this focus on protecting company secrets, this confirms that the startup nation doesn't really care about protecting citizens, but really, in fact, cares about business and protecting his poor friends. And this became blatantly obvious when you look at his at Macron's socials and economics policies. That's why we have like a lot of protests in France. I'm not sure you see a difference with regular time because we do protest a lot, but there is more protest at the moment. However, and even if Emmanuel Macron loves the European Union, it is to be noted that the German and French positions on this topic are not necessarily aligned anymore. The joint declaration I speak about earlier between Cazeneuve and de Maizière are the differences between the French and the German version, so it's not really a joint declaration, I think. And only France kept the part about how it would be great to have backdoors or golden keys. So either Germany doesn't want to publicly advocate for backdoors, or it has a different strategy. After going through some German parliamentary reports, it seems that the German strategy is to have access to content before and after encryption-decryption operation happens, which is somehow kind of a reduced threat on the collective freedom, but it means they want to install spyware and to target spyware, so they need to have like malware stored somewhere, and we all know it did not end well for the NSA and CIA and everyone else doing that for years. And also to not be a big threat, it should be carefully framed and controlled, which I'm not sure the German parliament can do. And it remains still it's still a threat, but not directly on cryptography. Oh, and I had to add that, as in France, in Germany, there has been election recently which changed the political balance in Germany, because the big coalition they had just kind of become fucked up, and they need to change it with the Green and Liberals entering the majority, if I'm following everything right. If some German person wants to bring more light on that after the talk, I'll be happy to talk about that. So position and point of accord need to be reevaluated. Macron and Merkel didn't have yet published their position on this topic, so we're waiting for that. I need to speak about Brexit, because we're talking about European Union and UK. So the UK position might not be a big player in the European Union anymore, so their position might not be as important, but Amber Rudd is out to bring cryptography to its knees, and it got support from the US government this Monday in an attempt to force Silicon Valley company to collaborate with police investigation. It seems that they want to regulate access to cryptography, but their main concern is that cryptography, as it is used nowadays, defeats the purpose of search warrants. So I think that everyone who wrote cryptographic tools and encrypting system deserves a big round of applause, because they can't break it anymore. So thanks for that. And lastly, in France, probably taking inspiration from the US, there's a pressure to add in the law the possibility for cops to ask for all your online handles, including that all your mailboxes, your Twitter or Facebook account, and all the weird nicknames you ever used on IRC. That's why mine is currently a fork bomb embedded in a shell shock. And I think there might be a way to be more destructive with 15 bytes when cops would have to enter it into their system. So let's be creative there, people. So, and if you can find some bobby tables to enter into a police form to just drop the database of everything, it might be fun, I think. Where do we go from here? France is one of the most active powers against cryptography in the European Union, even if some other member states did express some concern, namely Poland, Croatia, Hungary, Italy, and Latvia. Those concerns have been prompted by an inquiry made by some member state, probably France. We are not really sure about that, but we suspect strongly that it's France. And with each new law, there's a risk to reduce the use of cryptography, and we will have a lot of them in France with the penal, digital, or judiciary reforms that are coming next, the fact that Macron is using a lot of presidential decrees, and we are waiting for a report by the European Commission on this topic, and it's due this month. It is important to understand that at the European level, this position is mostly the French one. It's not even the German one anymore. We're not sure about that. So it is coming from a local issue. The excuse that it comes from the Commission will probably then be used by the same French government to justify their position, because parliamentarians do like to say, it's the fault of the Europe if we have this law, while you, at the first time, made those propositions to the European Commission, and then it's coming back at you. It's also important to understand that today, cops don't really need warrants anymore to search through your devices or houses or to arrest you for whatever reason they came to their mind, and they're kind of twisted. So, as technicians, what can we do? I think we should operate communication infrastructure and system in an illegal and clandestine way. It is important to build undetectable and encrypted communication system which breaks the link between your online communications and yourself. Making those tools available to the general public and mass adopted by them is a critical and non-trivial issue to address, because if we rely on the Play Store and on the App Store to deliver them encrypted communication, we have the blockade by the INSSI in the registration process. But I think it's paramount to think wider. Because if your encrypted communication requires a centralized infrastructure and a highly identifying piece of information, such as, for instance, a phone number, then a passive listener, which can access metadata, like, for instance, using the black boxes, can then identify yourself quite easily and link that to your link you to some protest, for instance, because they have IMSI capture. And once they got your phone number, they can legally wiretap and install keyloggers and spywares on your communication systems too. And in France, you can't be sent for 1 year to jail for just kicking a police car in protest. It's if you want to have a reduced time, you should kick a cop. It's like 6 months. If you hit a car, it's 1 year of jail time. So I think it's critical to have access to communication systems which are free, pseudonymous, decentralized, and distributed to the widest audience possible, and to think about ways to push those tools everywhere. It is also important to lead political battles, not necessarily by going to the parliament, but to lead political battles. We, as a French organization working at the French and European level, we need all available help to slow down this attack at the European level. Go talk to your local organization who fights for your digital rights, and tell them to just slap anything that comes from a French representative and to just call bullshit on that. There's nothing good coming from us, French people, at the European level. Just don't listen to them. We also need to get out of the security discourses, like cryptography is for security. And we need to counter the argument which say that only people committing crimes and felony do use cryptography. And I think one way to do that is to create and promote a positive discourse about cryptography, how it helps people with their lives, how it improves social structures. We should also probably consider getting those old specialty, French specialty back online, the guillotine. Lastly, and I think some of you can be of help here, we know that Emmanuel Macron and his troops are using Telegram to, and there is group chat for La République En Marche. And I heard allegations about the solidity of the protocol and cryptography used, and I also heard that you might be the crowd who can't break this kind of stuff. I also think that we have some media who run secure drop instances, such as, for instance, Mediapart, and I think they might be interested in having access to those conversations. So, if ever you're getting bored by French politics, you can still help us, feel free. And I think it's time to prove them why it's fundamental to have access to strong cryptography without backdoors, without reglementation and registration, and which enables everyone to stay anonymous or pseudonymous in their communications. Thank you for listening, and if you have questions or points you want to discuss, I think we have like 5 minutes, and I'll be there.
Thank you. Can we have the nice picture of the flag again? Questions? No. Any questions? I would like to make a comment on one of your last points about relying on Google Play, the Play Store, and the App Store. So I've been in Barcelona for the last few weeks. You probably know what's been going on there. If you really want to see what happens when all of the kind of attacks and things, when a nation state wants to take down the internet infrastructure of some people that are trying to secede or become independent or whatever, you can see that. And one of the interesting things was that there was an app, a Google app, made to find out where you could vote. Okay, so it was an app, and the Catalan president tweeted about that app, and immediately that app was taken down. And not only that, but every single other thing that the app developer had done in the Play Store was also taken down. Okay, so if you're trying to do an independence movement or any kind of movement or whatever, and you're relying on Google or basically any internet infrastructure, because practically the entire internet infrastructure of the Catalan government was taken down or removed in some way, it's not going to happen. If you're relying on the current infrastructures, people started to look at other infrastructures. They started to look at other apps. People were downloading Briar. I don't know if anybody here is familiar with Briar. Well, I think maybe there's somebody, well, maybe she's not in the room, that kind of was working on that. So it's a really, really, really important point, and it's happening now. And if you're trying to rely on these things, you're fucked. So I don't know whether anybody's got any comments.
I mean, surely such a freedom-loving country like France, for example, well, Liberté and things like that, surely you wouldn't be banning encryption, right?
You're asking if the EU should be banned the encryption systems, or did I get that wrong?
France couldn't be a country because it loves freedom.
Oh, yeah, it's like a PR stunt. Basically, we're trying to close down all the mosques we can. We have cops just beating up on people for no reasons and killing people. We're not the country of freedom and liberty, égalité, fraternité, not anymore. We invented that like 300 years ago, but we really are not a country of freedom nowadays. It's getting worse and worse by the day.
So we can't expect friends to save us. Any other questions, comments, etc.? Okay, so we know what the situation is. We know there was some advice there for things to do, and that you guys, the people in the room, can do something. So if you want to speak to Joaquin Mas about it or whatever, speak to you later. Thank you very much.